on stage. Front person, the whole song. Her back's acting up, or is it just her?
Hello, sunshine. How are you doing today? Oh, fine frog here.
Lighter. on Facebook Live. We are so glad you are here. So glad you are worshiping with us this morning. Randy and Cameron and Aaron are still in Tanzania on the ground there. I'm not on Facebook, but I understand they did hit water.
Aaron's not there.
He came back. Okay. Grant and Mandy and Aaron are back here. But understand they did hit water, so they're getting that, all the components of that well put together, and they will be traveling back this week. So praise God for that. Praise God for just Mandy and Aaron and Grant being back here and safe travels there. We're so thankful for that, too. Randy will be back next week to share all the things that they've experienced there and the great work and God's kingdom that's going on there. So you come back next week, you be a part of that. You invite people to understand and come and see more and open their hearts about all the work that's going on there in God's kingdom. We are so thankful today. We had Tracy back here again with us. He was here about 2 weeks ago, and I've used that shine thing a few times myself since he preached that sermon. So we're looking forward to that. Let's just open the word of prayer.
Father, we just give you praise and glory this morning for who you are. Lord, we just ask you this morning just to be with us as we worship you, Father. Just speak to our hearts, our minds, our spirit, Lord. Give us the guidance that we need. And we ask, Father, that you speak through Tracy as he brings the word. And Lord, we just, everything we do, Father, we want to do in your honor and for your glory. We ask it all in the name of Jesus.
Smiles are free to give, free to give. Why don't you turn around and give somebody a hug, handshake, or a smile?
Thank you.
started our prayer time this morning, we just want to continue to pray for the team still on the ground there in Tanzania, that they just complete the work that's going on there, not only to bring just water, physical water, but to bring the water of life to all that are there. And I know it's going to be a great experience for them. Things like that, you get much more than you give. And I'm sure Randy will be sharing that with us when he comes back next week. So continue to pray for that. Just pray the provisions, the logistics, all the things they need to continue to minister there, to continue to bring water, to continue to build churches there, to have the resources to do that, and just pray for all of that. Also want to just pray for safe travel back this week. It's later this week that Randy and Cameron will be coming back. Continue prayers for our sons and our daughters. Just hunger for prayer for God's word, for evangelism, just His holy anointing on this church in A180 and all the churches and the homeless shelters here in town. We really want to lift up the families in Branson for the boating accident that happened there. Just such a tragic event there. So we just want to lift those families up and just pray for peace and comfort in that situation. On our health issues, continue to pray for Krista Bercher, for Jack Mechanic, for Dave Capps, and Chris Ilberry, for Diane James, and for Glenna Johnson, and Phyllis Johnson, for Leslie King, for Herman Levy, for Jackie Rector, for Bella Reynolds, for Tim Reynolds, that's Tim Reynolds' daughter, for Marilyn Smith-Peters, for Aaron Steele and his foot to continue to heal, for Carrie Stover, for Patsy Tim's son, for Edwina, and for her cancer patients, Dwayne and Jackson Morton and Melvin Stanley and Gene Phillips. God bless you. Are there other praises or prayer requests out there?
My sister-in-law, her mother Vera Webb is next door at Nature Trail Home Hospice, so just pray for the family during this time.
Yes.
I have a praise. The kids at Almond Camp, and they had a great time. Allison got baptized, so she was there.
Great. All right, let's go to God in prayer. Jesus, we just come before you right now, and Lord, we thank you for going to that cross, for paying our sin debt, Lord. Thank you for the free gift of grace and love and mercy that you pour out on us. Lord, we just pray that you would open our hearts and our minds this morning just to receive you and receive your word and draw closer to you. Father, use us, plant seeds in us that we might go out and sow those seeds with others. Let us be a reflection of you, a reflection of your light. Let us always shine. May others know that we're Christians, and may others want to seek and see you and come to know you. Father, we just pray for the team in Tanzania. We just lift them up to you that they, this week, that they just get all the loose ends tied up and everything completed on the water well and well on their way to the seeds of new churches started there. We pray for their safe return. Lord, for all of the victims and the families, Lord, at the accident there in Branson, Father, we just pray for your peace and your comfort upon them. May they know you. May they know that you're there in times of trials and tribulations. And you didn't promise us that life would be easy, but you did promise that you will always be there for us. And all we need to do is reach out to you. Father, we pray, we lift them up, and we just pray for the peace beyond understanding that can only come from you. Lord, we pray for each of our health issues that we mentioned, Lord. We just pray for healing there, for the healing power that comes from you. And Lord, most of all, we pray not only for the physical healing, but for the spiritual health of each and every one of us. So, Father, go with us through this service today. May it be a joyful time of just worship, of lifting you up in praise. We give you all praise, honor, and glory. Amen.
alive. Isn't that some song? What a loss.
Yes.
I feel sorry for people who are dead. Really good. How do you think you can make God smile? How do you think you can make God smile? Think about that a moment. When you brag on parents, their child, our children, have done something really wonderful, and you brag on them, what do? They frown at you? No, they don't. They smile. So think about God today when we're up here at this time taking communion. How anybody in the world in this communion, I don't know, and you know that God smiles on us when we're taking communion. Not only just the communion, but if you leave this church and you go out among the people, strangers and heathens, I call them, that don't know Christ, and you say, are you a Christian? They will say, yes, most of the time. But if you ask them where they're going to spend eternity, that changes things right quick. And you can open up a lot of conversation that way. And when you do, you tell them about Jesus. And you know right now that Jesus, our God, will smile because you're bragging on Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so very much for life. We thank you for this opportunity to meet here, to remember Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, and what he's done for us. Gives us life, just like the song said, we're alive. Thank you so very much for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Meditation today is one single verse, Psalm chapter 40, Verse 5, the scripture reads this way. Lord my God, you have done many things, your wonderful works and your plans for us. None can compare with you. If I were to record and speak of them, they are more than can be told. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for giving us life and breath and the ability to be here with our church family. Thank you already for the blessings of the day that are too numerous to mention. Father, I pray that you would take this offering, that we would give it from willing and happy hearts, and see your blessing on it for the purposes that you have intended. In Jesus' name, amen.
Back. So the reality of the matter is, I don't know if that says more about you or about me. But all I know is I had to write a second sermon, so you all better appreciate it. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you. Thank you so much for your church. I thank you for Southwest Christian Church and our partnership that we have in the gospel. I thank you for the mission that we share to bring a lost and dying world back to you. Father, thank you for allowing this opportunity to be your ambassadors, to be your co-heirs, to be your co-workers. That just blows my mind. To be called your co-worker. Thank you for this awesome mission you've given us. Today, help us to hear your word and see just a little bit more about what that means. We give you all praise. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Getting a Christmas present for my mom was always one of the hardest challenges of my life. My mom never gave me anything solid to go on. I would ask her what she wanted for Christmas, and it was the same thing every year. My mother said, I want peace on earth. And I thought, who doesn't want that? You know, I would be seriously fine if I just had peace right here. I'm just not sure that I'm willing to pay the price for peace. I thought about the letters that we wrote to Santa when we were kids. I don't know if you remember the letters you wrote. I don't remember the specifics of my letters, but I do know that every letter had some kind of variation on a theme. And the theme was, Dear Santa, I have been a very good boy this year. Some of you may write your letters as, Dear Santa, let me explain. We wanted Santa to come. And we wanted him to bring something besides coal in our stocking. And so what we did was we prefaced our wish list with the reasons why it would be a good idea for the guy in the red suit to come down the chimney. Now we're older, our Christmas list is noticeably shorter. I don't care so much about getting the Atari 2600 or Stretch Armstrong, although Stretch Armstrong is cool, don't get me wrong on that. I think I would be fine. I would be fine with this. I want you to think of Philippians 4 today, which is where we're going to be. I want you to think of Philippians 4 as cookies and milk. Laid out on a coffee table, welcoming peace into the home. I wish you peace. And this is how you get it. We're starting in verse 2 of Philippians chapter 4. It says, I plead with Euodia and I plead with Syntyche, be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women. Euodia and Syntyche were two ladies in the church who apparently had trouble getting along. Wow, I am sure glad that doesn't happen today. You know what's funny? Names in the Bible mean something. When people are given a name, it has significance. The name Euodia means successful. The name Syntyche means lucky. They don't necessarily seem so lucky or successful at the moment. They seem to be having a disagreement. The Apostle Paul understood about disagreements. He fought with Barnabas while on a missionary journey. He scolded Peter for ignoring new Gentile converts. He challenged religious leaders and he even called out Caesar himself. Maybe that's why his tone is so mellow. He's not yelling at them, but he's calling them out. Paul doesn't mention people like this by name very often, so it must have been important. I think the importance might lie in the fact that he has been challenging the church to think like Christ. He's used that word a lot in Philippians, think. Here it's translated, be of the same mind. But it's the same word he used back in chapter 2 when I was here a couple weeks ago. When he said about being like-minded in Christ, one in spirit and in purpose. And look what Paul tells the rest of the church to do. He pleads with Euodia and Syntyche, but his plea doesn't stop there. What else does he say? He says, I ask you, my companion, my sister church, help them. I was outside my freshman year in high school when somebody told me, Jeff and Dwayne are fighting. Jeff and Dwayne were two of the toughest kids in high school, two of the toughest kids in my class. And and two of my closest friends. So I ran over to watch. I might as well have been selling popcorn. I'm not sure which is sad. The fact that people in the church fight, or that other people in the church stand around and watch. There are a lot of things that God's people can argue about. Some people like vanilla ice cream, some people like chocolate. I even know a person that likes white chocolate raspberry truffle. No names, Lori. Some people get up at the crack of dawn, others get up at the crack of noon. Some people are Cubs fans and others are just wrong. Now I'm never getting my bag. If I'm going out, I'm going out with a bag. Christ Church draws people from all kinds of backgrounds. They have varied interests and goals and hopes and desires. And truth be told, you and I might not agree on much of anything. But if you want peace, there's one place in which we must agree. The price of peace is having the same mind as Christ. If you want peace, that's what you've got to do. And not only do you have to do that, you've got to help others to do the same thing. That's what the Bible means when it talks about unity. Do you remember that one time in the Bible when Jesus prayed for you specifically? He said, I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be, church said, Father, as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe you have sent me. Do you catch the purpose behind that? Unity is not unity for unity's sake. Unity is unity with a purpose. It's a plan. It's a mission. And that unity brings other people to Christ. We don't have to agree on everything. But if we agree on the one thing that matters, Jesus is Lord, and I will be like Jesus, then the world will understand. Do you want to tip Mount Vernon over? Then agree. Agree to help one another think like Jesus. We believe that peace is impossible because we are in conflict with others. Folks, if there's anyone who understood conflict, it was Jesus. But look what Paul said about Jesus earlier in Philippians. He said, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset. There's that word again. The word think permeates the book of Philippians. Have the same mindset as Jesus. Do you want peace? Then think like Jesus thinks. He didn't use his power to his advantage, but he made himself nothing. He took on the nature of a servant. He humbled himself. And Jesus is the only thing that matters. I don't know about you, but when I go before the throne on the day of judgment, when I close my eyes on this life and I open my eyes in glory, I want to have confidence when I approach the judgment seat of God. Do you want to have confidence when you approach the judgment seat of God? How would you like to know that when it's all said and done, when you awaken in glory, that you will be confident before the Father? You do realize God's word tells us how we can do. Specifically, John tells the church this. Now catch what he says. He says, this is how love is made complete in us so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. Are you ready? I think about what he's about to say is important to you. This is how we have confidence in this work. We are like Jesus. Jesus had conflict. Peace is not the absence of conflict. Peace is not total agreement with everyone on every issue. Peace is the understanding of the only thing, the only one who is truly important. I think that's important, and I don't think it's a coincidence that the very next thing Paul says is this. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Rejoice.
There is no difference between you and me that will separate us as long as we have one another be like Jesus. Rejoice! We have a peace that the world cannot help but be drawn to. Rejoice! The Lord is near.
If there's a lesson I've learned from this text, it's this. Price of peace is the presence of the Prince of Peace. Guys, too many of us want peace without the hard work that goes with it. We want the peace from conflict. We want the peace from the situation. We want the peace from the issue. But we just as soon do it without Jesus. I read on Facebook all the time, all the Sunday morning confessions before I come to church. People that have been enjoying life Monday through Saturday, then on Sunday morning they get on Facebook and complain, wonder where God went. Why doesn't Jesus say, why can't I catch a break? Love that one. Why can't I catch a break? Well, maybe because you want peace on your own terms. You want peace when your life and your choices remove God from the equation. You see, the way we get peace is not on our terms. The way we get peace is total surrender. And that's costly. Guys, peace isn't the absence of conflict. Peace is the presence of God. Here's what Paul told the church in Rome. He said, the mind governed by the flesh is death. But the mind governed by the Spirit is life. Peace. Peace doesn't come when all the problems go away. Peace comes from total surrender to God. There is no sin that will be more important than your walk with Jesus. There is no opinion that you have that will be more important than your allegiance to the King and helping others to think and live like Jesus. Do not be anxious about anything, Paul says. But in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. I'll admit, when I read this verse when I was younger, this verse bothered me because I thought, how can you go to your knees in prayer and not be anxious about things? I think it's perfectly okay, even biblical, to be concerned for situations and people in need. I think back to Nehemiah. When he saw the condition of Jerusalem, and he saw that the walls were torn down, and he saw the temple was in disrepair, and Nehemiah tells us that he was driven to his knees, weeping for the situation that was there. I don't think that's an issue. I think that kind of anxiety is what brings you to your knees in the first place. That God gives us a heart for others and a desire for Him to act mightily in their lives. But there is a fundamental difference between having a concern for others and worrying that God isn't able to do His thing. There are lots of things and lots of people that we're concerned about. But if you want peace, then the one thing you cannot worry about is whether or not God is going to be God. Some people say, I pray all the time. Why isn't God responding? I counter with this. No, you are not praying all the time. You are worrying all the time. And there's a difference between the two. When you stop your prayer with, I'm worried, then you never leave the situation in the hands of the one who is strong. Your prayers can begin with, I'm worried about. I am anxious about. But they need to end with, thank you. Thank you that you are the one who will deal with this situation. Thank you that it is not my job to fix this problem. Thank you for the peace that your presence provides. Thank you that you gave me your mind to love and serve others as you would. And when you have the mind of Christ, when you live your life in His presence, when you are confident in God's will as you pray, when you pay the price of peace, look what Paul says happens. You get peace. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. The world does not get the peace of God, and I understand it, because half the time, I don't get it either. Most of the time, when the word guard is used in the New Testament, it refers to a prison. That doesn't make any sense. Peace cannot be a prison. But there is another meaning, and I want to take you back to Psalm 28 to show you what I mean. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in Him, and He helps me. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I will praise Him. The Lord is the strength of His people, a fortress of salvation for His anointed one. Peace is not a prison. It's a shield. Peace is not a prison. It's a fortress. If you want peace, quit trying to do God's job for Him. You are not the shield. You are the child behind shield. You are not the fortress. You're just the lucky soul who gets to live in it. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. I don't get how my God built this fortress around my life. I don't understand how He put His shield in front of me. So I'm just going to live here and enjoy it. Peace is a mindset. Peace is a decision. Philippians is a book that teaches us how to think. And so that's how Paul ends our section. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever's noble, whatever's right, whatever's pure, whatever's lovely, whatever's admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. All the way back to chapter verse 2 when we started, I choose to never allow my disagreements to get in the way of the main thing. I choose to have the same mind as Jesus. I choose to celebrate the presence of God. I choose to bring my concerns to God and never allow my worry to overcome His power. I choose to live behind His shield. I choose to live in His fortress and let Him carry the load. And the way I will continue that peace is I will choose to think about the things that my Jesus thinks about. You know what I love about Paul's list here? You don't see it in the text. You kind of have to go back a little bit. It's a transition Paul gives us, an interesting one, from biblical to worldly. There's a break between the first four words. He says, finally, brothers, whatever is what?
True.
Whatever is? No, that's a biblical word. Whatever is? That's a biblical word. Whatever is? Pure. Okay. Those are biblical words. Those are church words. Those are words you stand up on Sunday morning and say, this is fantastic. But then he transitions. After whatever is pure, he says, whatever is what?
Lovely.
Whatever is. Oh, those aren't church words. Those are cultural words. Paul tells the church to see the beauty in all of God's creation. Not just what we consider to be churchy. A sunset. A baby's laugh. A really good joke. A really good cry. Your favorite band. All of those things. We look at all this stuff and sometimes we think, well, it doesn't necessarily fit the spiritual model. You know what? My grandson, my God created my grandson. When my grandson laughs, I see my God. A beautiful sunset. My favorite bands in the entire world are all named after place names. Chicago, Kansas, Boston, Asia. Listen to them all the time. Love their music, love their stuff. My other band's Survivor, but didn't fit the description. So if you want peace, there are things to do. The and things to think about, and there are things not to do. How many of you know Bob Newhart? Do you remember Bob Newhart? He's still with us, okay? Watch, we know Big Bang Theory, he's still around, okay? Bob Newhart did a skit where he played the counselor. If you know this skit, keep your mouth shut. He told his clients that he only charged $5 for the first 5 minutes of his counseling session. And then nothing after that, because the sessions rarely lasted more than 5 minutes. And in the skit, a person comes in and tells them about their situation, and Bob Newhart says this. He says, I'm going to say two words to you right now. I want you to listen to them very, very carefully. Then I want you to take them out of the office with you and incorporate them into your life. Anybody here remember this skit? You know where this is going? Good, good. Get a surprise. Church? I'm going to say two words to you right now. I want you to listen to them very, very carefully, and then I want you to take them out of the church with you and incorporate them into your life. Are you ready? Do you want to write these words down? Do you want to embrace them? Do you want to tattoo them on your forehead so that other people will see them? Here is Bob's Newhart's wisdom for dealing with the problems in your life. Stop it. S-T-O-P. Next word, I-T. Peace means getting a hold of your brain and saying, stop it! When those disagreements threaten your biblical relations with others, stop it! When gentleness is the furthest thing from your mind, stop it! When you're tempted to carry your worries instead of giving them to the God who can handle them, stop it! When you're tempted to think anything but the thoughts of Jesus, stop it. And some of you are like, but Tracy, I can't stop it. Well, the Apostle Paul seemed to think that you could. Here's what he told the church at Corinth. And the church at Corinth was a mixed up bunch of people. And if the church at Corinth, as pathetic as they were, could figure it out, I suspect that Southwest can. Look what he says. He says, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient. Your mind belongs to Christ, but it must be made to obey Christ. So every thought that comes out of your head goes through a filter. And it doesn't pass the test, it never sees the light of day. What was that filter? Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. My Christmas wish list is pretty simple. I wish you peace. And here's how you get it. I will think like Jesus. And I will help others around me to do the same thing. I will welcome the presence of Christ and quit trying to do his job. I will take every thought captive for Christ, and I will stop every thought that comes between me and the Father. I wish you peace. And stretch arms. Father, we thank you for your blessing, for your mercy. We thank you for your peace that you provide. I pray today that we would hear your heart and know that your peace comes at a price. You paid the price when you died on the cross. When you were raised from the dead to a new life that we get to share, and we are thankful for that, right? I also know there's a price that we need to pay. Father, that price is you. It's your presence in our life. It's your understanding that your call is paramount above every issue and opinion that we have. Father, help us to think like you. Help us to help others to think like you. Father, help us as the writer of Isaiah 16, when Isaiah says that we are literally basking in your light.
And the people are drawn to that light, like wise men to a star over the stable in Bethlehem. So they may come and participate and enjoy what it is that you have given to us. Father, we want peace. Help us to size up the cost and pay it. Because there's nothing better than the peace of Christ that transcends all understanding, guarding our hearts and minds and being. Father, we come to you sometimes as anxious people. Father, today may our anxiety lead us to our knees. But may our confidence in you lead us to our feet for action. To live out the price of peace.
As we sing our song of invitation, if you have a burden on your heart, if you want to bring that burden down here and leave it at the altar, we invite you to come down here and leave the benches on either side and leave that anxiety, leave that worry here. If you want to accept Jesus, we'll make that happen again this morning too. Come down and confess your belief in him. Won't you stand as we sing? Sunday, that means it's fellowship dinner Sunday, so you come, you invite all your friends, We're going to hear about all the trip to Tanzania, as well as have a fellowship dinner. Bring a slide or a dessert and come and have a time of fellowship. After that, later that day, next Sunday at 5 to 7 at the Rec Club, we're having a pool party, so we want to be a part of that too. We thank Tracy for coming and bringing us a message. Tracy, you come back and visit us again, please. And so we're going to remember this. We're going to remember stopping. I know where we're going. I know where we're going. I'm pointing behind you. I'm not going to forget. Right? So, before we close today, in the back there are two little twin girls back there, twin tornadoes. Chelsea and Whitney, the Nichols twins, they are 3 years old today, right? And right over here, Ruth's birthday is this week, and she's 97 years old. Whoa. Shine our light to others. Shine a light that only comes from you. Let it shine through us that others may see, may seek you, may know you. We give you all praise, honor, and glory, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.